those monies will be turned over to the general fund. But the attorney that represented us the first phase of the trial was Jay Tallerman, and the second phase will be Bob Brooks, who's
pending litigation.
Yeah. Attorney Sullivan, or excuse me, Assessor Sullivan, given the fact that it's still pending litigation, we really shouldn't be getting into that discussion here today.
Okay. Well, I just
we understand this decision, I appreciate it, we're all read it, so I think we should probably leave it at that, gentlemen.
Thank you,
Mr. Chair.
Anyway, this is the insert that we would propose to submit with the upcoming tax bill.
Any questions? I had one. Do we typically put, I noticed in here the couple of comments about the override. Do we typically do that? I mean, not that we pass overrides very frequently.
We did last override as well.
Did we do it last override? I mean, I think.
Whatever the last one was.
I imagine it'll save some phone calls because people will.
That's the point, yeah.
And did we discuss the other insert?
Not yet, no. They were on first.
So we want to do it separately?
In the queue after these folks.
Okay.
Yep.
Great. Craig?
Motion, Mr. Chair?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to approve that non-political municipal information materials may be included with the property tax bills according to MGL Chapter 60, Section 3A.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous, 5-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, very Merry Christmas.
Tony?
Yeah, just bring up to speed. The applicant to the Affordable Housing Trust.
Bring John up to speed.
Yeah. And, yeah, sorry. The applicant to the Affordable Housing Trust, Ruth Wagner, called in ill, so she was not able to appear before us, and so we can address whether to appoint or not at 12,
fair enough,
when we get to number 12. And item number 6 has also been postponed.
Got that one.
Okay. So,
great. So let's move on to number 5,
right,
which is a discussion.
Well, you still, point of order, Mr. Chair,
yes,
you still have Mr. O'Connell for the insert.
Oh, okay, so we're going to put that.
Yeah.
Great.
Good evening, board members. My name's Jim O'Connell. I'm the conservation agent, natural resource officer, and conservation department head. I'm here to seek your permission to put an insert in with the tax bills. It's an educational floodplain brochure. This activity, inserting a floodplain brochure to all the residents and business owners in the floodplain, is part of the community rating system. The community rating system is a volunteer program run by the Federal Emergency Management Agency. If a community decides to adopt the community rating system, there's a series of activities that are required to be met. Each activity has certain points. When you meet certain levels of points, all the residents that own properties in the floodplain get a reduction in their flood insurance premiums. At the present time, the town of Scituate has been participating in the community rating system for a number of years now. They're a Class 8 under the community rating system. That means that every resident every property in the floodplain gets a 10% reduction in their floodplain premiums. The town of Scituate has met 19 separate activities every year, from maintaining an educational library, educational information in the library. We do educational workshop every year. We maintain elevation certificates, and we do put out educational brochures such as the one that I have here, in this round we're going to mail to all the residents in the floodplain. Right now we're meeting the Class 8 requirement. The community rating system is going to be radically changed next year. There's a new manual coming out, which the conservation agent is generally the coordinator of the community rating system. Just for mailing these brochures out to the floodplain residents, the number of points that they get in all these programs in this new revision to the community rating system requirements is going to double, because they consider education of floodplain residents in terms of what to do in preparing for a storm, how to protect your property or reduce the potential for damage to your property, and the importance of maintaining flood insurance in the event of a flood is so critical that they have actually doubled the points for mailing out these brochures. In the coming year, we're going to write another an additional brochure to talk about some of the actual savings that people get by participating in the community rating system and doing certain things such as elevating your house 1 or 2 feet above the base flood elevation will reduce your flood insurance premiums even further. So there's a lot of information in here about protecting your property, protecting the contents of your property, and protecting basically lives and the health of people in the floodplain. So we'd like to maintain our class 8 under the community rating system, and this is one of the requirements that we need to do every year. So we'd like to put these within the tax bills that are going out this month.
That doesn't take a vote or anything, does it?
I think it does. Yeah.
Maybe leave some at town hall, post offices. Can you do that, Jim?
Yes, we can. As the present time, we do have them in the conservation office. We have just enough left over of this brochure here to mail to all the floodplain residents. There's another requirement that we have met over a number of years, that we mail this floodplain brochure to every resident in the town so that they can be aware of flood insurance and be aware of the things that the town is doing to help maintain the properties in a safe condition and help protect people themselves. So we're going to be doing another. We only have enough this year to mail out to all the floodplain residents. We will be redoing this brochure starting now and finishing in the next fiscal year, and we can print enough to basically have them in a number of places around town.
Just two quick points. We've historically done this. Did it last year, I believe, right?
Last year was the only year that we missed because the conservation agent is generally the coordinator for it, but we didn't miss it. Basically, when I came on, we caught up. Okay. So, but it was mailed out last year, yes.
And how many residents are in the floodplain?
Approximately 20, a little over 21, about 2,100.
2,100, wow.
Yeah.
Motion, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, please.
I move the Board of Selectmen vote to approve that non-political municipal information materials may be included with the property tax bills according to Mass General Laws, Chapter 60, Sections 3A.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Jim, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Okay, now we'll move on to number 5, which is a change to the mooring regulations. The Harbor Master, Mark Patterson. As well as waterways. Mr. Murphy, how are you?
Gentlemen, fine, thanks. How are you? Mark Patterson, I'm the Scituate Harbor Master, and I'm here tonight with John Murphy, who is the Chairman of the Waterways Commission. And we're here tonight to propose a change to the mooring regulations governing the application on the mooring waiting list. Just a couple of things that we think we hope will improve the process for the folks who are out there waiting to get moorings, along with another part to this, which is the proposed amnesty for folks who came off the list in 2010 due to the Harbor Master's office not sending out reminders in that year. We had, although it's not part of the written policies and procedures, for several years sent out reminders out of courtesy. That was not done in 2010, and it turns out that some of the folks who were on the list had come to rely on those reminders to come in. So as a result of that, we are again proposing to allow this one-time amnesty for those folks to be reinstated to the list. They'd be notified by the Harbor Master's office and told how to proceed. In addition to that, we are proposing to change the deadline, the annual deadline for confirming your intent to stay on the waiting list, from December the 20th to December the 31st. It's just the end of the year. It seems like a little better date for folks to keep in the back of their mind. In addition to that, proposing a grace period for individuals or folks who forget to sign the application by the deadline. They'll have 1 month, the month of January, to come in, pay a $50 late fee, and have their name put back on the waiting list during that grace period.
Comment? Seems simple enough. I think it's a good idea. I think, you know, the little glitch that came up last year.
Yeah.
And it's understandable on everyone's end, but I think this solves it, and I think everyone should be happy. I think it's a good idea.
Thank you.
Yeah, December 20th is tough. It's this day of year. Everybody's thinking Christmas, and they got a deadline. Maybe they shouldn't procrastinate that much, but I think the 31st is more applicable. With a one-month grace period, we had a lot of discussion on this, and it seems to be the best solution to move forward.
Plus, I like the idea of they're giving amnesty for the people for last year who were penalized for it.
at least this year, you're giving an opportunity for them to come back on the list, which is equitable, and I think that's admirable that the committee and Mark, that you took a look at that. And certainly giving them an opportunity, one last opportunity, that in the event, in the wake of maybe holidays and everything else, they've got one additional month until January 31st to make payment plus an additional penalty fee for failure to do it by the 31st of the year. So commend you all for doing it. It makes sense.
Motion?
Sure.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to amend the mooring rules and regulations revised July 2004, Chapter 1 of DTBD, per the recommendation of the Harbor Master and Waterways Commissioner.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. Before we vote, just two quick questions. The people that come back on the list, do they go back in the slot that they were in before?
They'll go back to with their date of, their original date of application.
And that's how it's ranked. And just how many people are on the list now?
How many about? Are on the list?
Yeah, about.
Between 500 and 600.
500 and 600.
There's several classifications according to length, so it's not just one list. There's five lists. Something like
six lists, yeah.
But collectively.
Great. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous, 5-0. Thank you guys very much.
Merry Christmas.
Good holiday. Merry Christmas. Number 6 has been postponed, so we'll move on to number 7, which is a vote to change the shellfish regulations. Joe, how are you?
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm Joe Strasdis, the shellfish warden, and basically there's only 3 items that we'd like to add, and one clarification. They're in bold. Now, the last time we visited this was in 2005, and these are just, the first one is number 4. Extending the number of days you can dig during the months of December, January, and February. I mean, it's so unfavorable. If you can get out in a good day, get out. So for those 3 months, taking off the just Thursday, Sunday digging regulation. But for the rest of the year, you know, it's back to Thursdays and Sundays. And also, particularly in the rivers, adding number 5, making it illegal to dig shellfish or sea worms in the grass near the roots and in any way disrupting the bankings of any marshes, which they should know anyways, but it's in black and white now, so that they can't say they didn't know. Number 15 was just a clarification as to what kind of clam should be 2 inches, a soft shell. The sea clams and the quahogs are different sizes. But. And number 16, to cut down the amount of shellfish that are damaged, no digging when it's 32 degrees or lower, because anything you leave exposed, if you're able to dig in that weather and you go out there, it's going to be frozen and you'd lose the the babies, which are your resource for the future. And those are the only changes. Any questions, gentlemen?
Great. Mr. Murray?
Yeah, I approve all these, Joe, and this is well done. My only suggestion was maybe linking number 4 and number 16, just like in number 4, where you're talking about during the months of December, January, and February, shellfishing shall be allowed any day of the week. You might want to just there say, please also see number 16, which is the one that says can't dig when the air temperature is below 32, because there are a significant number of days in January and February that are below 32, and I'd hate for that to get lost in the shuffle. I mean, someone who reads through thoroughly will know that, but just a little pointer probably wouldn't hurt.
Very good. Or put it in twice.
Yeah.
Good. So just to reiterate, number 4 is during the non-winter months, you can only dig on Thursdays and Sundays, and during the winter months, you can dig any day of the week, provided that the temperature is above 32. Mr. Harris?
How did the project go? And you reseeded or you transplanted some cherry stones, didn't you, from?
Mr. Daphne and Mr. Patterson took the lead in that, and they did a remarkable job distributing them. Mr. Daphne has harvested some of them, from what I understand, and the state did test them. They are suitable to.
He didn't get sick, so it must be.
He didn't
be
get
good.
Sick. The state did test them, and the meats were able to be eaten. So it's just a hearty soul to go out there and find him this time of year, since those are under the water.
Great. Motion?
Motion, Chairman. Please. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to approve changes to the shellfish regulations dated January 10th, 1995. Per the recommendations of the shellfish warden.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danny. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous again.
Thanks, gentlemen, have a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thanks, Joe. Stay warm. Moving on to number eight, we're going to discuss the fees and rates at the golf course. Mr. Sampson.
Merry Christmas.
How are you, Bob?
Bob Sanderson from Widow's Walk, and I'm here to request a selective price increase, which is never a enjoyable recommendation, particularly because I consider most of the people who this affects to be my friends, but I do feel it's a necessity at this time. In preparing the budget, it just was very difficult to balance without some kind of increases to go into effect. I've selected three areas that seem to be most lagging behind our competition. The first one is the golf carts, which I have proposed a $1 increase to a cart rental, which would be a proposed revenue gain of approximately $15,000 for the season. Season passes, which based on some of the backup that I've given you, they would increase anywhere from $50 to $100 for a season pass, and that would generate about $9,000 in additional revenue.
How much would
$9,000 total, and junior greens fees. Once again, with the backup I have, you can see that we are quite a bit behind our competition in that area. I don't believe we've had a price increase in that area for over a dozen years, and a $2 to $3 increase, 9 holes, 18 holes, would be a projected revenue gain of $3,000. I should add here that in regards to the season passes, I have proposed a new player's pass that I would like to institute. It would actually give some of the people who are currently season pass holders an option to go into a different plan that indeed may actually save them some money. We have a lot of seniors who just play 9 holes, and these players' passes can kind of you can get kind of creative with packaging things, and I think that some people who are, you know, strictly a 9-hole player, for example, may benefit to go that other route, whereas some of these other people who regularly play at least a couple times a week, and I must say that our season pass was started in 1999, and in the history of our season pass, the original season pass, the price has actually come down $50 since its inception, and they have gotten some additional perks, such as it used to be that on a day that was restricted from their season pass, they just paid the going rate. Now they pay half price greens fees on a Friday if it's a restricted day, and they pay half price greens fees on Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays after 10 a.m. So, as they say, not only has the price actually gone down, but the perks have gotten better. One of the pieces of information I've given you is a comparison of revenues based on the first 4 months of the fiscal years. I was doing this up at the end of October, and you'll see that we, much like everyone else across the country, are facing shrinking golf rounds. It's just a fact that's out there. You'll see that we hit our peak back in, I believe it was 08, and I do remember that was a particularly good weather year. But if you look at 07, 640,000, and then, as they say, 699, which was the weather had something to do with that. And then 2009, 651, almost 652,000. But since then, you see that there is a steady decline. 651 to 6, well, say 652 to 636 to 622 to this year, 602. Now, I must say, we were very fortunate that we had tremendous weather at the end of the year. The month of November, we did pick up a lot of the slack, but we can't count on that every year. So I think we're back where we may actually be a little bit ahead of last year because of the good November, and actually December a little bit.
Bob, if we can go back one step, you said that you were going to make a plan better for some of the seniors and other programs on your what was it called? The
in your packet, the player pass, right. It's the player's pass in your packet.
So is that gonna negate some of the savings you're suggesting from these other people?
I think it's gonna bring a whole new group of people as possible frequent golfers at Widow's Walk. Because it's gonna give the people who are primarily weekend golfers, it's gonna give them a program that they can get involved with.
And if I understand it correctly, you actually buy a bucket of rounds.
Exactly.
So you're buying 10 rounds or 25 rounds or 50 rounds at a discounted rate.
And, of course, the discounts get progressively better as you purchase the bigger ones. And I think there's a lot of people that fall into that category because when we first started our season pass, it was to boost our weekday activity. The weekend play at that time was pretty solid. We really didn't have the banquet facility and so on to be able to attract outings successfully, so we decided to go to this season pass. But it wasn't really part of the original intent. It was supposed to be just strictly daily fee, and they really, you know, at the start, they weren't interested in any kind of memberships at all. Now, the weekends early in the mornings continue to be strong, but they seem to drop off earlier. So I'm hoping if we can get this, you know, a new group of core golfers. And certainly my feeling is that the more people we can get to purchase these packets when they're discussing where they're going to play that weekend or that day with their friends, then they've got more incentive to visit Widow's Walk and hopefully bring their friends with them. So
you think that'll have an increase?
Oh, I do. I think I feel really strong about it. In fact, I would, you know, I'm looking forward to do some local advertising with it.
Now, the other comment on revenue, I know Joe will probably reiterate this. A couple years ago, we actually lowered the prices and gave probably the best deal on the South Shore in terms of being able to play around for $39. And are those staying the same?
Yeah. We will continue to do those, but that's, you know, what I would consider to be off-peak times. You know, that's, and that's part of, if we have our normal prices where they're a little bit closer to our competition, then certainly, you know, those deals become even that much more attractive. So there certainly are opportunities for people to get out and save some money if they want to play at the times that are less in demand.
I just have one comment, Mr. Chairman, and to Bob. We charge the golf team as it is $300 a year, which is a minimal fee. Is that correct?
No, we don't charge the golf team anything. That's if when somebody makes the golf team, the coach gives me a list of those names, any underclassmen, they are able to purchase a season pass for $300.
Okay, so it's a little, all right. So we don't charge the golf team
$300. No, they practice.
That's fine.
For free.
Yeah, during the season, we have not charged them anything.
Fine, thank you. Which is good. I think everything I've heard about them, they're like all sports teams in the town. They're great ambassadors for the town when they go out, when they play other towns at other courses, and nothing but praise from people who have come in contact with them. So,
and a lot of the golf team are members at Hatherley. So yeah. we have a handful who have taken that $300. Deal, and as you can see, I mean, you know, with the enclosure, you'll see actually how affordable some of these season passes are. Like the golf team, it's $8 a week.
Yep.
If you put it over, and even the junior membership is $12 a
yep.
week. which is...
A nice deal.
Very reasonable, and, you know, even the adult ones, if you look at a per-week cost, you don't have to play a lot of golf to get your money's worth out of it.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
There's an audience. What'd you say? I think someone in the audience had their hand up. Yes, sir.
Hi. If you buy the...
You just have... Say your name and address, please.
Paul Schiff, 57 Ocean Drive. If you buy the 50-round players package and you don't use them all up, can you carry them home? Or can you buy advanced rounds into next year?
This is actually designed much like the season pass to be for that calendar year. And
so the answer is no.
Yeah, I mean, if in doubt, I would suggest go to the 25 and...
Right. Use it or lose it, in other words.
Yeah, I mean, depending on which one you do, for example, on the weekend one, that will be discounted enough where somebody wouldn't be opposed to using that on a weekday because it's still going to save them... $9 a round, even if they use it on a lower price day.
Now, I think in looking at these, you know, it looks like there's some good deals here. It's kind of tough to look at it without looking at the whole component of the major, just the people that play that don't, you know, our major source of revenue is just our regular greens fees rates. And that's really not in, we're not really looking at that. You know, we're kind of taking the small piece of the puzzle and looking at that and not looking at the two or three other components. I don't know what you guys thought about, you know, I mean, when I look at, you know, increasing the fees on juniors to get $3,000 in revenue, where I think that's one of the bigger markets that we can tap in. And obviously the longevity of the game is based on us getting juniors in there. You know, although we're not, you know, we're still under what the competition is, it just,
We're a fair amount under most of the competition. I mean, I realize that the junior golf is the future of the game, and I think that we're just being a little overly fair right now. I remember seeing anybody that was less than 15 and 25, I believe, if my memory's right. And
24.
Yeah.
So we propose to go from 14 to 21. Is
no, we're proposing to go from 9 holes and 18 holes, $12 and 18 right now, mm-hmm. and propose to go to 14 and 21. And I guess in some ways you can look at this like you can't hire a babysitter for that if you really – I mean, if you think that you drop your child off and they are out at the golf course for 5 hours for $21, that's pretty reasonable. You know.
Good thought, actually.
Got a good point.
Take four-year-olds?
I can see what Tony's going. It you know, you're trying to encourage, you know, young people to go out there, and if it doesn't make that much of a difference, you know.
Well, you just wonder if you raise our regular greens fees by 50 cents, if it would triple that savings. You know, so that I guess that's the only part. When I was looking at this stuff, I didn't get a good sense in terms of what our regular greens fees were compared to everybody else, and is that really where we're missing? You know, are we nitpicking on these little things and not getting the major one? Although none of these were, like you said, none of them are these outlanders that it's...
When you say regular greens fees, you mean the, not the passes, but just the regular fee?
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about the golf carts,
yeah,
you know, the junior programs, and then the senior passes.
Well, all the passes. Mm. There are a number of different season passes now.
Right, the ones you've listed, 7-day weekend, junior, senior,
yeah.
and golf team.
I mean, they're not senior passes. I mean,
I'm sorry,
senior's
I meant
one of them.
Yeah, I meant season, sorry.
Jim, yes. To your point, I think if you raise, and if we decided to raise the regular green fees by $1, certainly not a number that's going to drive people away, we probably look at the numbers would bring in $25,000 yes. in the ballpark.
Well, if carts go up 15 by raising it $1, you got two people in a cart. So
yeah, but even 30, if you leave the carts the way they are, just
no, I'm saying yeah. just number wise, yeah. it's got to be around that.
It's got to be around that. I mean, would that be, if we want to get into the black, if we don't want to be doing this every year trying to make up nickels and dimes, should we not think about going up a a nominal, minimal dollar around is not going to drive anybody to anywhere else. Or do you have a different view on it?
I just try to pick the areas that I thought that we were most lagging behind our competition. We did do a price increase 2 years ago on our regular greens fees. I know that we raised the weekend fees and the weekday fees. So I just feel like we're a little bit closer to the competition in those areas than we are in the ones that I selected. But I mean,
well, I think Rick, the board discussed this last year in terms of the junior. I mean, even if you split the difference and go half of what Bob's recommending, it's still by far the lowest rate. You haven't looked at the rate in 13 years. I mean, it's a delicate balance between not turning golfers away across all the lines and, you know, making sure that the golf course is solvent. And even with these increases, even adding a dollar to the greens fees, it's not going to be solvent in FY13.
Right. See, I think that was my next point.
Right.
I don't think we can really vote. You know, you can't kind of have to look at the both pictures. You know, where's this going to bring our revenue, and is that enough to sustain the operation? You know, at some point, we've got to get the revenues to match the expenses. Does this get us there? And per Tricia, it doesn't look like it does. So there's going to have to be additional cuts in expenses or increases in revenue. So,
well, you already have my recommended budget, and the reason Bob is here tonight is because you need to decide this, because he needs to do his marketing and advance in renewals for all the season passes. That's why I did his budget early, and it's an approved budget that you have. It's actually lower than it was in FY12. So, and in my view, I can't cut his expense line items anymore. So in terms of additional revenue, Bob, I don't know if you can wait till January 3rd, but part of the reason to get him in here now is because he needs to do his marketing and his renewals with the different rates so he can get his brochures out. So,
so Bob, do these changes get you to the 1.273 that you need to get to?
Well, I'm hoping that this player's pass is going to be successful. I'm hoping to get a little bit more traffic. We've got a little bit of Groupon activity there's about a little less than a thousand of them that weren't used, and now the deal is done. But people, if they do come, they'll have to pay the difference. I mean, they still will have the Groupon that will be worth the value that they paid for it, but they will no longer have the deal because it did expire. So we've got that revenue, and we do have another interesting new program that we're going to get involved with for the month of May. So I'm hoping that some of those things will increase the rounds, but I must say it's a very challenging time for trying to increase golf rounds.
Okay.
So certainly if you're in favor of increasing the regular fees by a dollar or two, then you know, I certainly would be in favor of that as well.
Well, you could always come back. We could always vote this tonight to get you to be able to go forward with the budget. And if you, after thinking about it, you could always go back in February or March or even April asking for a dollar increase or whatever.
Well, I think the reason we're doing this is because he's got certain marketing stuff.
Yeah, but by doing this tonight, he'll be able to do that.
Yeah, but he'll be wrong for the whatever rates he changes.
Then his marketing will include the green space.
Yeah. I mean, I think there just has to be some analysis that says here's how I'm going to get to, I'm sorry, what was the number, 1.273.
Most of the marketing that we're talking about and the work that I'd like, it really affects the season passes more than it does the regular greens fees, because the regular greens fees, basically, I could change those. I mean, I would rather decide going into the year rather than do it in the middle of the year, you know, based on a fiscal year period. I would rather set the rates and just go forward with them for the year. That would be my preference. But what's more important as far as mailing is first of all deciding on what the season pass rates are going to be, so that I can send the literature out there and let them know about this new players pass, because some of them may say, oh, okay, then I would prefer to go this other route anyways. So at least, you know, they kind of know where they're going for 2012.
So with what he's recommending tonight, absent the increase in the greens fees, that's a $27,000 projection in additional revenue. I have a projected deficit already of $76,000, so that nets you down to about 50 right there. If you add a dollar to the greens fees, I think that's another net of about $27,000, which puts you at new revenue of 54, which still leaves you a projected deficit of 22,000. That's more in keeping with the deficit you've run the last 3 years. But come June 30th in the fall, that needs to be made up with general fund funds if it's a shortfall, because mm-hmm. we have no retained earnings as of June 30th.
Mr. Murray.
Bob, just briefly, what is the greens fee, the typical fee that you're talking about potentially raising by, or we're talking about potentially raising by a dollar? What is it? And maybe there's no one, but just a typical value. I'm not a golfer. Well, I need some calibration. Just give me a number.
The 18-hole weekend green fee is $45 presently, and the weekday 18-hole green fee is $37 presently.
Okay, thank you. And you said you raised it a couple years ago?
We raised it in 2009,
and
2 years ago.
How mm-hmm. much did you raise it then?
At that time, I know we raised the weekend green fee from 42 up to 45, and I think we...
Plus three, okay.
Yeah, and the weekday, it was either 2 or 3 there as well. It might have been 34 to 37. It might have been 35 to 37. I don't
But that sort of scale, I appreciate that. And then the other question that I had is, and I know there's no ranking of this, but just offhand, and maybe you guys can answer this too, since you all golf more than I do, certainly. Is that $45 and $37, is that right in the middle of the pack, or is that expensive, or is that like really inexpensive, or what? I just have no idea.
It's I would call it a very good value. I'd say that we're a little bit below our competition, and I would say that our golf course compares favorably. So it's not, but I think that...
okay, that's good. You know, so you golfers on the board, if someone calls you up and say, hey, let's go golfing at course X, and they name some course in some other town, they say it's going to cost $45. Is your immediate reaction is that's about right, or is that like, oh my God, that's really expensive, or gee, that's a really cheap thing? It seems like it's right in the middle.
Yeah.
So that's, I don't see why raising a dollar from 45 to 46 is going to, as Joe said earlier, steer people away. And if it's a way of raising up $25,000, $28,000, $30,000, I think that's essentially in the noise compared to differences that the weather might bring on us in terms of the numbers of fees. If we were talking about raising 45 to 55 or some huge percentage, but a dollar?
Yeah.
And that is an unbiased, non-golfing perspective on it. So maybe I'm completely wrong, but that's just my gut feeling on this.
Yeah, I have no problems doing what Bob's suggesting as far as increasing the rates and the proposed or the Players Pass program. The only thing I'm thinking of after hearing Tricia saying that, okay, if we increase the fees by a dollar, we're still going to run a deficit of $22,000 with it. So why don't we just raise it $2 with the expectation that it's going to run efficiently and do and continue the proposal that Bob's doing? I mean, one way or the other, what we're going to run into is we're going to have a special town meeting, knowing right now that they may be running a deficit next year. Why don't we just cut to the chase, increase it by $2 to hopefully cover the budget, give you the additional, and then hopefully we won't have a special town meeting on your budget. Hopefully not either. So
raise it by $3 and make money.
just
seems I agree, $2.
This makes sense. Yeah. $2 is not a whole heck of a lot of a big difference. I mean, if you're going to increase it by 5 or 10, I totally agree, but right. I'm like, at this point, you know, now I do feel like we're getting into dollars and cents, but I think it just makes sense to do the additional. God bless.
Well, I think that's what my point is. We need that piece of paper that says, here's how my revenue is going to get to 1.273, and I need to increase this by this, this by this, this by this, this by this, and then we say yes, or we say, look, don't increase this one, increase this one by 2 or whatever.
But I think if we incorporate the increases that Bob's suggesting, plus a $2 per round increase in the green fees, that will get us to that number. One, I mean, it'll come off a close. A couple of bad weekends, and the numbers gone anyway, so, weather-wise, so.
Right, it's all weather.
So, it's all weather-related, but I think this, at least on paper, we can get to that number.
And I think you, we can see, I mean, with the revenue per round enclosure that we have, and just looking at the 18-hole equivalents, and taking a look at the regular, which is almost 10,000 rounds, and the seniors, which is, you know, so to add those up quickly and multiply times $2, and then that's going to give us a feel for what we're talking about, yeah, as far, you know.
Yeah. So that would be my suggestion, following up with what John said, that we raise it by $2 and get it over with.
That's, Mr. Harris?
It all sounds good. What's it cost to go to Green Harbor, you know, or North Hill, or
South Shore?
South Shore, you know, because that's what we're going to hear. You know,
South Shore has always been quite a bit higher than us.
Okay, good.
In fact, we have had their residents come to play our place, and even with their resident rate, they can play cheaper at Widow's Walk. So. I must say that their product has gotten much better of late, and before the product I didn't think was as good as ours either. Green Harbor is very close to us, but certainly all of the Plymouth courses are much, much higher than we are.
What about Pembroke?
Pembroke's higher, definitely higher.
I don't have any problem with the increases. I'm just saying, we just should see the analysis that says, here's what it is. This is what my plan is, and then we can gauge to it and see what we missed next year, if we miss, or where we exceeded it, and go from there. But I agree with John. I don't think a dollar or two here or there, although our scenario 2 years ago was, let's drop it $5 because our sales are going to double because of that.
Well, so $5 is a big difference than one or two as well, in either direction.
Three.
So.
But
again, I think we have to, you know, we've said this before, it's so weather related. You get a bad month of May and all these projections and numbers go out the window. All we can do is,
well, we can't be that close then.
We can't be, well, we, you know, it's a crapshoot. You just hope that you get weather that'll bring people there, that's all.
Remember that $5 that you're talking about, that was just a special. I mean, that wasn't all the time. That was like you know, afternoons on the weekends and things, which are, you know, generally your slower periods, which as I say, by increasing the regular rate, if we keep that, the deal rate the way it is, then that's even that much more attractive for, you know, which it'd be nice to be able to fill the off-peak times and give people incentive to go there. And I think the other times will continue to pretty much keep, you know, stay about the same as they have been. So, I wouldn't object to the, the $2 across the board.
Here's my final thought. I think the golf course has to be self-sufficient. You know, we can't go to the taxpayer and say, we need you to cover 50 grand or 30 grand. So tell us what the rates have to be self-sufficient, and then we'll vote on them.
Okay.
So if you think that these three things are going to get us there, then it sounds like we support it. I mean, somehow it just has to be a plan from you that says, here's what we have to put our rates at, and let's do it. Yes.
Are you suggesting that we don't vote on this tonight? Because
I don't have a problem voting. If he wants to do marketing on the season passes and stuff, I don't think there's any big marketing for the juniors or for the, maybe there are golf carts. I mean, the golf carts kind of work hand in hand with the greens fees. I mean,
I think he hasn't laid it out as you're suggesting. I agree with you, but I like the idea of moving on this with the $2 and seeing how that goes for this year. And because it's the rough analysis is there in terms of the numbers of rounds times two additional dollars. It does within, I mean, I think getting within 10,000 or 20,000 projected is probably the best we can ever do. And unless we really try to strategically exceed the weather buffer, right, which would be probably an increase of $5, something like that. So then I think we probably are playing with the economics of getting diminishing returns. $5 might turn away too many potential players, and so the net might not work.
So I'm hesitant to do, to go too detailed beyond this point, although I sympathize with your goals, considering what we've got laid out.
I just think us at a meeting saying, let's raise it $2, and that's what's going to solve the problem, seems kind of makeshift. Mr. Danny?
Bob, if we were to postpone, when's our next meeting, Kim, if I may ask?
January 3rd.
January 3rd. If we were to postpone it till January 3rd in 2 weeks, can you go back, go through the numbers, and will that delay any marketing plan that you have right now between now and then, 2 weeks?
I mean, it's doable. I guess I haven't seen Tricia's, you know, how the revised budget yet, but it seems like it's pretty much here with this 10, you know, it looks like another 13,000. So we hit 27,000 and another 13,000 is, 13,000 rounds, which is, you know, approximately another $26,000. So we're looking at $53,000 roughly. These numbers that I have here.
I probably would propose this. If you just go back, run the numbers, make sure the numbers cover the projected expenses and potential shortfall for next year. So at least we know the final number. So if you come back and you say, okay, guess what? We actually need to increase it $3. That's the number. It covers it. It maybe gives you a cushion of $5,000 or $10,000. That's fine. I mean, I'm happy to vote on it tonight, but my attitude is if you run that and it's not going to impact your ability to market the fees for the next 2 weeks, then I'd say, why don't we just get it all done one foul swoop as opposed to trying to inch our way up this way or that way. Does that make sense to you or help you?
It's fine if that's what you, you know.
I'm fine with that.
Either way, vote it tonight, vote it then. Either way.
All right.
So we're talking about a couple weeks from now.
And I'd be guaranteeing, well, I can't guarantee. I can tell you I won't have any questions if you come in with like $2 or $3 and right. Everything else. I think you're going right. to be in and out of here in like 3 minutes, right. I think.
But it's got to be your plan. So this is your plan, and then we've got your budget to work off of on the revenue side. And then it's not just us saying, let's raise this by 50 cents.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sounds fair enough.
Great. So we'll see you on the 3rd. Okay, very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we'll move on to item number 9, which is the statement of interest for Gates Intermediate School. Anyone want to come up? Hi, guys.
Hi, good evening. So
we have the principal and assistant principal from Gates, and congratulations, Jim, on the interim superintendent, Jim Kelleher, just recently announced, I believe. Congratulations.
So we are here tonight to get your approval for a statement of interest that we would like to submit to the MSBA for a potential building project for the Gates Intermediate School. We feel that there are two reasons why we need to look at a building project for Gates. First, with regard to the facility itself is the main portion, nearing 95 years old next year, and the building envelope and the systems within it are nearing or have outlived their useful life and are in need of either repair or replacement. Secondly, the building itself does not facilitate a true middle school model. That is something we are working hard to be able to achieve, but the building presents a lot of obstacles in our achieving that goal. And so what we are hoping is that either through a renovation or a new building, we are one able to provide a more modern and safe building, and two, able to provide a building that will help us facilitate a middle school model and an education that fits 21st century teaching and learning.
Yeah, I know we've all looked at the statement of interest, and a couple quick points, and I'm sure other people will chime in. You know, the one thing I want to get across to everybody that's watching this and everyone here, the building is safe.
Absolutely.
There's no health concerns. There's no ceiling is going to fall on anyone's head. Is it efficient? No. You know, the windows are old. The heating system's overworked. It costs way too much money to run the building, but there's no safety or health concerns in the building. So we can put that aside.
As a matter of fact, we just had the entire building tested in terms of air quality, and the building is fine. I know that was a major concern of some people, and the building is fine.
Right. The rumors go around quickly, so that's good for everyone to know that it was tested again, and it was tested just three or six months ago prior to that.
Oh, yeah.
And it is still
safe.
You know, safe and air quality is good. The other thing is, you know, this whole project goes hand in hand with really the master plan of what we're trying to figure out with all the town facilities and what we're going to do with town hall and with police stations and with senior centers and with libraries and with community and all this sort of stuff. So, you know, that's one of the components that we've talked about a lot to figure out how do all the pieces go together. So, you know, so I think the way I understand this document is we're not making a commitment to fix gates or rebuild gates, because that may not be where we want gates to be in 2 months, 6 months, 2 years, 10 years, whatever the time period happens to be. But this is just the next step of getting in the queue to
exactly.
possibly getting money and
right.
having someone come in and evaluate the educational status of the building.
Right. Absolutely.
So that's the way I understand it. Anyone else have any?
You summed up everything that I thought of, yeah. Mr. Chairman.
I think. No, I have nothing. Just unless is there anything else? Make a motion to have the clerk read the resolution, I guess.
Yeah. I just have a question. I mean, because you both said it, but I want to make sure I understand. So this does not commit us to staying in Gates as a school, because we have this feasibility study coming up, which is going to be out in
February, beginning of February.
It's a preliminary study in April. That was the one question I had about the dates in here. It said that they'll go to the town. It says the feasibility is done in February, which isn't quite accurate, and that the town will then seek full funding for a feasibility study on Gates for design work, and that the town would seek a capital debt exclusion at a special town meeting in the fall or April 2 town meeting. And I realize these are estimates at best and probably ambitious, but given that the feasibility study isn't even going to be awarded to January 3rd,
right.
The selected vendors agreed to have the preliminary or something for town meeting, but that contract never required that to be completed until March or April at best.
That's a
depending
good point.
On the due diligence, but it sounds like you folks have already done a lot of due diligence in putting this together, so I think they'll be able to hit the ground running in terms of compiling data and chatting with you folks. So it might be, but again, they were just supposed to have sort of preliminary, and then hopefully we'll at least at a minimum be able to give town meeting a report on, you know, what the findings are for that.
But philosophically, I think we're all on the same page. This is something we've all certainly talked about, and you folks have talked about. We're well aware. I mean, Gates has been an issue for a long time, and we all want to move forward, as you said, with renovation or a new school. Mm-hmm. And this is part of the process going on. And there's going to be other aspects of the process that are going to be brought in as well as we move forward.
And you know, just if we've kind of missed the obvious, the reason why we're doing this is because if you get accepted, the state pays for 40-something percent of your work. So, you know, that's what the MSBA program is. So whether it's renovating the current school or building a new school, or I mean, it only deals with that portion of the whole master project that deals with the school, but it could be a significant amount of money, as we've seen in our neighboring communities. Both Hingham and Marshfield you know, have gotten significant amounts of money. So I think generally we all support the fact that if we can improve a building, we want to do it, and we just want to make sure that we don't do it as a silo, and that it's really in coordination with everything that's going on. Mr. Hayes, I see you just walked in. I didn't know if you had anything to add.
No, no.
Okay, I'll let you catch your breath, and if you, if you think of something, raise your hand. Yes.
Hi, Jen Morrison, 60 Mordecai Lincoln Road. Just wanted to say that you guys are here tonight in support of to urge all of you to vote in favor of the statement of interest to move forward on this first step.
We don't need urging, but we are.
But we always appreciate, yes. We always appreciate hearing community support for what we're doing.
And that's what it takes. It takes people to be interested and push the cause, and Jen, obviously you've been, you know, pushing this, and I think it's great. Mr. Harris.
No one else anything to say. I was just doing the math. The last time any renovations were done to that building, I think Mr. Hebert might have been a teacher. That was like 1975 when I went in as a seventh grader.
First year teaching.
I had just missed that, and I was one of the lucky, you know, children to go into the junior high. It was newly renovated. I don't know what the cost was, but, you know, that was the last time that was significantly renovated. It was pretty, you know, it was a long time ago.
As the clerk, do you want me to read?
Actually, one second.
Sure.
I think, Mr.
Well, just sure. I mean, we had spent a lot of money there. We spent $1 million there.
I'm not saying you didn't. No, no, you don't take it the wrong way, but a whole big, right.
Yeah.
Great. If that's it, then if you want to read the motion, I think it has to go verbatim of the...
Yeah, it needs to go verbatim. It's a resolution, and I'm going to read it as a motion, but it's resolved or moved. Kim, I wanted to say both words in case both words needed to be said officially. Having convened in an open meeting on December 20th, 2011, the Board of Selectmen of Scituate, in accordance with its charter, bylaws, and ordinances, has voted to authorize the superintendent to submit to the Massachusetts School Building Authority statement of interest form dated December 21st, 2011 for the Gates Intermediate School located 327 First Parish Road, Scituate, Massachusetts, which describes and explains the following deficiencies in the priority categories for which an application may be submitted to the Massachusetts School Building Authority in the future. Priority 1, aging HVAC system, failing windows, leaking roof, and accessibility issues. Priority 2, 64% of our general education classrooms fall below the recommended 850 square feet. Priority 5, nearly all of the infrastructure systems in the envelope of the Gates Intermediate School are in need of major repair or replacement. Priority 7, the Gates Intermediate School cannot meet its primary goal of being a true middle school with the current facility. The building itself precludes us from having grades 6 to 8 and significantly impedes the team model of a middle school. And hereby further specifically acknowledges that by submitting the statement of interest form, the Massachusetts School Building Authority in no way guarantees the acceptance or the approval of an application, the awarding of a grant, or any other funding commitment from the Massachusetts School Building Authority, or commits the Scituate School District to filing an application for funding with the Massachusetts School Building Authority.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danhey. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. It is unanimous.
Thank
Good
you
luck
very
getting
much.
The application in, and we'll be talking about it a lot over the next several months.
Look forward to it. Good. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Hayes.
Good morning. I just want to mention, didn't know, I think you all know, but Jim is here tonight. Jim, we appointed as our interim superintendent last night, starting January 2nd, and we're very grateful he's accepted that job, and he will be, week's time, he will be our go-to man.
Yep, we mentioned that before you got here, and everyone got up and cheered. No. Good luck, Jim, and...
So, Jim, by January 4th, we want to see some.
That's right. That loan.
Yeah.
See you, Jen.
That's
it. Bye, Jen. Okay, moving on to item number 11. Are we on 11? Was that 10?
10.
Item number 10, I'm sorry. Thanks, John.
Would you like a motion? There's a new one up there, Tony. I've been instructed on how to read it.
Great. And yes, I do want a motion then.
Okay. Folks, there's going to be six different motions here that I'll just go in order.
That's just so they know. This is annual renewals.
Okay. Annual license renewals.
License renewals.
After the first one, you'll get the hang of where we're going here. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following liquor licenses for 2012. Barker Tavern, Scituate Tavern, Cosmos Cafe, Front Street Gourmet Wine and Spirits, Gannett Grill, Harborside Wine and Spirits, Hatherley Golf Club, Mill Wharf Restaurant, Oral Restaurant, Inn at Scituate Harbor, The Village Market, PJ's Country House, Reynolds Package Store, Riva Restaurant, The River Club, Scituate Post Number 3169 VFW, Scituate Racket and Fitness, Scituate Harbor Yacht Club, Sands End Cafe, Sands End Retail, Finn's, Scituate Country Club, Scituate Package Store, TK O'Malley's Sports Cafe, Tedeschi's Food Shop, Town of Scituate, Widow's Walk, The Winery, and Backyard Burger Bar.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danahy. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Move the Board of Selectmen...
Oh, good, I thought you were gonna go...
Yeah, just...
Good, do them all.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to...
Do them all.
This is one of the opportunities of being clerk. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following common victor's licenses for 2012. Barker Tavern, Scituate Tavern, Cosmos Cafe, Front Street Gourmet Wine and Spirits, Gannett Grill, Hadley Golf Club, Mill Wharf Restaurant, Oral Restaurant, Inn at Scituate Harbor, The Village Market, PJ's Country House, Reynolds Package Store, Riva Restaurant, The River Club, Scituate Post 3169 VFW, Scituate Country Club, Scituate Racket and Fitness, Scituate Harbor Yacht Club, Finn's, Sands End Cafe, TK O'Malley Sports Cafe, Tedeschi's Food Shop, Town of Scituate, Widow's Walk, The Winery, and Backyard Burger Bar.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danahy. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. It's unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the following entertainment licenses for 2012. Barker Tavern, Gannett Grill, Hadley Golf Club, Mill Wharf Restaurant, Inn at Scituate Harbor, PJ's Country House, The River Club, Scituate Post 3169 VFW, Scituate Country Club, Scituate Harbor Yacht Club, Finn's, Sands End Cafe, TK O'Malley Sports Cafe, and Backyard Burger Bar.
Second.
Second by Mr. Hanning. Further discussion? One quick comment on this, just to reassure that there's been no complaints that I know of in terms of an entertainment license that we'd like to discuss further.
That's correct.
That I know of.
That's correct.
So this would be the time for that we would do anything if there was any complaints. So that being said, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It is unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the Hawker Peddler's license for the Gannett Grill for 2012.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danahy. Further discussion?
Yeah, I didn't think we were doing Hawker's Peddlers, and why are we doing this one?
Good point. I'm sorry.
No, that's all right.
I'll retract the motion.
You're absolutely right. Please do. Yes, I apologize.
I'll retract the motion.
Second.
Withdrawal.
Second.
I'll second that withdrawal.
Actually, we never voted, so.
Okay. Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the innkeeper's license for the inn at Scituate Harbor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Aye. It's 4-0. One abstention.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the common victor's license for Coffee Corner and Ronnie Shones for 2012.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danahy. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It is unanimous. 5-0. Thank you, Rick.
You're very welcome.
Now we'll move on to number 11, which is to close the annual town meeting warrant. The annual town meeting is April 9th to, oops, no, would that be 2012?
Move the Board of Selectmen close the annual town meeting warrant of April 9th, 2011. 2012, I'm sorry. That's my fault, I should have read it better. At 8:13 p.m.
Second.
Second by Mr. Murray. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It is unanimous. Moving on to item number
12,
which are the appointments. Do we want to postpone this because Ms. Wagner didn't get in here, or do we want to vote?
She's come before us, I think, before, and I'm quite comfortable with it.
I've talked to her.
Her resume was very strong.
Yeah, I actually encouraged her after the last interview we had with, I think, Conservation, and so I know she'd like to get involved.
Great.
Started.
Motion?
Sure. Got her first name, though. Ruth. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to appoint Ruth Wagner to the Affordable Housing Trust.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. It's unanimous. 5-0. Item number 13 is to discuss the meeting dates for the Board of Selectmen for the month of February 2012.
So we're not all just texting, we're all looking at our calendars here, folks.
So we're meeting on the 3rd?
Hold on. I gotta figure out how to do this.
We gotta look important, Joe.
Yeah.
Can you figure it out?
7th, February?
I know, but I mean January 3rd.
You mean January 3rd, 17th, 31st.
Whoa, whoa.
Well, that's January.
January what?
3rd, 17th, and 31st.
If you went to a two-week schedule in February, it would be the 14th and 28th.
We might be able to, we should have more meetings in February.
Do the budget calendar, say, do I need to go get it? They can't be losing meetings in February. At best, they're going to have to add a Wednesday or a Thursday meeting if they don't want to meet the week of February vacation. So let me get the budget schedule.
Should probably meet the 7th, 14th, or 21st, so the 7th.
Yeah. I always have.
This is the 20th, that'll be February vacation.
No, no, someone else does that.
It's always the 4th. It's the 3rd.
It's the one with the holiday.
That's it.
I've got us on the 7th.
Pretty sure I'm saying.
No, I don't have us on the 7th.
Yeah.
February vacation, I've got. Yep, that's it.
So it's the 20th.
Week of the 20th. I'd probably say, yeah, meet the 7th, 14th, and 28th.
Yeah.
Go back to
back. So what does that calendar say, Trish?
It says 2/7 and 2/21. So, and you want to bump the 2/21 meeting.
So we can meet that.
So 2/14 was Valentine's Day, which may or may not impact some decision making. It would for me. And
not feeling love up here.
2/28. Is there a 2/28?
That could go a lot of ways.
Yes.
There's a 2/29 this year.
2/29 this year.
Excuse me. I apologize. In looking at this, we need to go back to January just for a second because it's actually January 3rd, 17th, and 24th. And then February, as this stands, is February 7th.
Well, January, you are here, so.
Wait a minute. Say that again. I wasn't listening.
January 3rd, 17th, and 24th, and February 7th and 21st is how it stands right now with the way the budgets are set up. The 21st is the one that's in question, is that right?
Yes.
Yes, so what I'd like to just propose for discussion purposes is the 21st meeting. I know that week's a problem, but in terms of the budget calendar, you're supposed to vote the entire budget then. So for discussion purposes, I would suggest maybe Wednesday, February 15th. And that way you can lose the meeting on the 21st because you can't go a later week and you really, and that whole week's out. So.
Okay, so I'm confused. So you say the February 7th and then.
February 15th would be the Wednesday you don't want to meet on Valentine's Day.
Correct. So we do Wednesday the 15th.
And then you would lose the 21st.
Okay. Now, not do the 21st.
Trisha, can you go back to January? Because we have 3/17/24.
That's correct.
So we're not doing the 31st?
The 31st you don't have.
Why not?
Maybe. Well, we'll either do the 24th or the 31st, one of those.
Yeah, or you could do the 31st or the week of the 14th, February 14th.
Right. I think we should do the 15th because we're going to want as much time as possible to get the final budget done. So
February 15th.
February 15th. Does that work on your BlackBerry there, Sean?
Unfortunately, Angry Birds. Unfortunately, I'm here all the time.
Okay.
My skiing vacation got canceled, so.
I can do that.
So everyone can do the 15th?
7/15.
No, 2/15.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to do the 15th. Now let's talk about the January. Do we want to do the 24th or the 31st? Is anyone's schedule?
Wait.
Okay, that's new to me, and I mean I'm going to be moving.
I don't care what day.
Departments. So, and it.
So what day is it now? The 24th.
It's the 24th.
Okay. Can everyone make the 24th?
Yes.
Okay. So let's keep it the 24th.
So we'll just move the 21st meeting, Kim, to the 15th.
Right.
So that should work fine.
Okay. Wait. So just to make sure. So
I'll go through them real quick.
All right.
January 3rd. January 17th, January 24th.
Correct.
February 7th, and February 15th.
Yes.
And then what's after that? February 28th?
Yeah.
Well,
I just want to make sure.
Hold on. 3-2.
3-2?
Yeah, they're going to March.
3-2's a Friday.
3-2 is a Friday.
Yeah, that's just, so you're okay, so I don't know what your regular meeting schedule.
I got a February 28th on my calendar here, so at some point I was told there's a BOS meeting on February 28th, otherwise I wouldn't have put it in.
So it'll be the.
All right, 2/28.
Do we need that date?
I think you should keep it just in case you have a, in terms of the budget. And if we don't need it, we can cancel it, but the important date to move up was the 2/21, so I think we're okay. And that doesn't impact, is Mark still there? You are. That shouldn't impact yours.
So by February 15th, we have to do the budget, or does that mean we're having all the CPC articles and everything done by the 15th, or do they go after that date?
2/28, that's your meeting after. You review all the budgets, then you do CPC at the end.
Just in case we're missing a quorum, I just want to mention this. I am not going to be at the January 17th meeting, which is no problem, but as long as the other guys, as long as you guys are all going to be here.
I think.
Or at least three of you will be. Okay.
What date?
January 17th.
That's Waterways budget, right?
And Kim did give you in your packet a tentative list of the working warrant articles, which we need to discuss, because one of them is to change the dates in the charter, so we don't have to go through this excruciating process of trying to squeeze you all in February. It's admittedly busy.
Okay. So we're clear on the dates now. 3/17/24, 7/15/28.
Correct.
Okay, now do you want to go over, Trish, in this?
No, I think, you know, as you do the budgets and stuff, there's a few articles that we had talked about that were non-monetary in nature and some were. So I just wanted to give you a list of those articles that we have. There's a couple of things. I think I sent you folks an email about the Seawall Committee, and that needs some additional work. We talked briefly about a few charter changes and bond authorization decisions that I think we can talk about in the context of when Jane comes in to do the debt budget.
Okay. Great. Now, moving on to item number 14, the Town Administrator's Report.
I'd like to skip to item 2 before I go to item 1, if that's okay, Tony?
Yes.
Item 2, I guess I don't like to read verbatim, but I think in this sense it makes sense for the first. It's part of my report this week. I have to inform the board, which they're already aware of, that our town accountant, Mary Gallagher, has resigned her position. It is with mixed emotion that I officially report this, and Mary's been with us as our town accountant for almost 20 years, and will be leaving to become the finance director for the town of Cohasset, and you received her resignation, our official resignation this evening. This is a promotional opportunity for Mary, and one in which I know she'll serve admirably. She has served Scituate in a highly professional and competent manner, is deeply respected by town staff, and has ensured that our town has always been in timely compliance with all statutes and DOR requirements, as well as ensuring that our finances were reconciled. In the short 2 years I've known her, we've worked very closely together in overhauling and instituting new operating capital budget programs, as well as a multitude of other internal controls. Our success as a result of these changes is directly attributable to Mary, as she was right there with me, creating new forms, making suggestions for them to be even better, and educating town and school officials about what can and can't be done in municipal finance. So on behalf of everyone in Town Hall, we certainly wish her the best.
Mary, thank you for all the work you've done, and again, we wish you the best. You'll be right down the street.
Yeah.
And.
Close by.
It's a promotion for you.
It's a promotion. It was just the perfect opportunity.
Yep.
So that being said, Mary's promised to stay on and work nights and weekends to get us. Which I want her to acknowledge on TV for perpetuity, so we can get through this budget process. But given that she has demands from her new employer and will be leaving the middle of January, We need to make interim arrangements. We posted the job right away. Thank you, Joe, for posting it on the GFOA website. It's going to be in the Beacon. But we need interim accounting services. So I have arranged, starting the middle of January, for a temporary accounting firm to come in, Financial Advisory Associates, which Mary FAA knows, and Jane is familiar with them as well, as I am, having worked with them in the past. They will be giving me a proposal to do about a day and a half here a week. And what that will give us is they will run the warrant and ensure that the accounts payables are posted and the general ledger is kept up until we can get a body in here. Since this is not a salary line item but a purchase of services line item and will be more than Mary's currently hourly rate, we're going to have to reconcile some of that at year end. But at least I'm hopeful that, you know, our business will go forward and, you know, the stuff that we need to do will get done. As long as the budget's all done, it should be okay. But again, if there are changes to the budget through advisory selectmen as we go forward, that might be a little more challenging, and Mary knows about that. But at least we'll be able to have a Band-Aid for a while, and we'll see what the pool looks like for town accountant applicants.
Thank you.
And the other thing I have is the bid for food and beverage at the golf course, and Bob has stayed, is up in January. But even though January's around the corner, since the golf course is really not open till April, it's really not an issue because this food and beverage runs from April to, it's a 9-month period or a 12-month period, depending on whether they want to serve during the winter months. So this is a draft. Some of the dates need to be reconciled, and Bob's reviewed it again. What happened is I looked at the original RFP that went out 3 years ago and gave it to Bob to make some suggestions, and then decided I didn't want to use it, that it really didn't capture what the town needed to. And so I rewrote it and did it as a straight invitation for bid. One of the things when we were talking about the Golf Enterprise Fund earlier is the current revenue we receive from the food and beverage operation a year is $48,725. That's a pretty good rate for food and beverage. I've set a minimum bid in the RFP. I don't know if that's the number I'm going to go with. I need to talk further with Bob, but there is some degree of uncertainty with setting a minimum bid too high, or also sort of expecting we're going to continue to get what we get for the next 3 or 4 years. But we're certainly going to go out of the gate at this point with that expectation, because then that can again affect the revenue side once we do it. But the important thing is to go out to bid right away and see what we get.
Now, it says in here for 9 months.
Yeah.
So does that mean the establishment's closed for those other 3 months?
What the way I want to do it is, it's sort of going to be like an ad alternate. If the bidder wants to be open those 3 months, then they can say they want to, but at that point they're responsible for 100% of utilities. So we have to change those languages. Right now, how does it work now? Does Jamie work at his option, keeps it open? It's not in the bid, right? Right, it's not in the current contract.
So he's on a 9-month lease now?
Well, it was structured so that it was kind of an annual bid, but he paid it in 8 installments. And, you know, at first nobody chose to operate in the winter. And then, I guess, maybe 2 or 3 years ago, we decided to start operating, serving breakfast on the weekends right now.
Right.
So we'll do the 9-month term and then an option for them if they want to do the 3 months.
At a different rent.
But again, we would normally be closed, so I don't want us responsible for the utilities.
Okay.
Tony?
Yes.
Trish, I thought that contract went for another couple of years. I thought we just...
It did. It went forever, but it was not properly or legally authorized.
All right, this wasn't... All right, okay.
We had a multi-year contract, but this board until April of 2010 was only, I'm sorry, the fall of 2009 was only allowed to execute a 3-year contract legally. now, you can do up to a 5-year, which is why this one says 3 with an optional 2 years.
Right.
But the one, and I told Jamie shortly after I started that I would be going out to bid because he didn't have 5, he only had 3. So he knows about it and he's awaiting it, as well as, you know, we'll advertise with the regular folks.
Right, so we don't vote, this is just a draft for us to look at?
Just informational to let you know that it's out there, because you folks are in the community and hear things, and so I just wanted to let you know about it.
So, Bob, is it your feeling that he's gonna bid for this again? Is that work going fine for him, as far as you know?
I believe that his intention is to bid.
Okay. Because Rick raved about the breakfast there, and
it's good. Very good.
I'll be there.
Is that it?
Yep, that's it.
Great, move on to item number 15. Other business? Sean, any, anyone?
Nope.
No.
Mary?
One quick thing. John does a good job, as do we all, but John particularly with his business ties locally has been urging a lot of people to shop locally in this Christmas season. And I was doing that just that the other day, and I noticed there's just a lot of traffic on Front Street, which is a good sign, but some of the traffic was humming along pretty fast, and I almost saw some people get hit in crosswalks and stuff. And nothing overly dangerous to be concerned about, but I'm just wondering if perhaps the police could step up some oversight, particularly since there's so many people frequenting all the very good stores down there. It's just be a good thing to do. Tricia, could you bring that to the chief's attention?
Yeah, sorry, Rick, I was writing it down when you were speaking.
Yeah, no problem, because it's great. I mean, the stores are very busy and it's great stuff, but I just like that to be looked at. Particularly kind of coming out of the Cole Street, Cole Parkway parking lot down by the coffee shop that side. Maria's and all that. That's it for me.
Nope.
Oh, one more thing.
Sorry. You missed your chance.
You missed my chance. I know Tony was there. I don't know if any other people were there, but we were at the Jenkins School Music Concert the other night.
Yes.
And it was a lovely affair. Greg Lassar, Ms. Lawson, Betty Slosher, they all did a very, very nice job. It was standing room only, the back of the aisles. People were standing in the aisles and sitting in the aisles. And it was a really nice affair. And the school music people, they're a special group. They put a lot of time in, and there was band, there were my daughter's flutes, everybody was there. It was a very nicely done affair.
Yeah. It's a, you know, it's that time of year where every school has all their events going on and all the Christmas pageants and this sixth grade breakfast and all that stuff. So it's a great time of year. The only other thing I'll add is the Citizens of the Year banquet was a week or so ago. I think it was between our last two meetings, and Joan Power won, and it was a wonderful event, a huge turnout. The place was packed, and just hearing all the things that she's involved with was mind-boggling. So congratulations to her again. Senator Hedlund and Representative Cantwell were there, and it was a great event at the Barker, as always. And the committee, I think Joe was part of the committee that selected her. You know, she's truly deserving of that award. And Joe, did you have?
Nope. No. Thank you.
So, do we have anything else? Or do we go to executive session? Correspondence, I don't see any.
There is none, Mr. Chair.
There's some minutes, though.
Yep. Move to item 17, acceptance of the minutes.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of December 6, 2011.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Abstain.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of December 10th, 2011.
Second.
Second by Mr. Murray. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. 5-0.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the executive session minutes of November 29th, 2011 and December 10th, 2011.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. 5-0.
Finally, move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the executive session minutes of December 6, 2011.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That is 4-0. We are going to go into executive session now to discuss labor negotiations, and we will not return to regular session. So everyone have a safe and happy Christmas and happy holidays, and we will see you back after the new year on January 3rd. Good night,
folks.
Good night.